It's a place we all have to find, child. But it's not just a place where you eat or sleep. Home is knowing. Knowing your mind. Knowing your heart. Knowing your courage. If we know ourselves, we're always home, anywhere.
If you believe within your heart, you know that no one can.
Our show tonight, entitled To Be Woman, Gifted and Black, One Generation to Another, is a very special treat. We'll be talking to two very gifted women indeed. One, a legend established. The other, a legend in the making. I'm describing Lena Horne and Nikki Giovanni. Both appeared in Detroit recently on their tour together across the country, doing benefit performances for Delta Sigma Theta Telecommunications Incorporated. What you're about to enjoy speaks to the styles, outlooks, attitudes, and concerns of the black woman from different generations, but both sharing world fame. One is 63, and the other is 36. Both have a magnetic energy and inner strength and beauty that bridges the years that separate them. We will talk first with Lena, whose activities in the civil rights struggle has only added another dimension to her fame, and whose striking beauty continues to vibrate untarnished by the passing years. May I first of all say that your performance this evening, as always, was just outstanding.
Oh, you thank
you. You make it look so easy.
Yes, well, I think it was okay. The audience was super. And they're 90% of the show. If they're working, then it's easier for me.
The road to success for the black performer has not been an easy one. It seems to have changed. Has it changed?
Well, I think so. I think that the same kind of stresses that we had are not the same stresses that this present generation has at all. I wouldn't say that it's a lot better, but it's a little easier because they don't have to waste too much energy just doing basic things like finding out if you are permitted to work somewhere, you know. That's over and done with. But their success is much quicker. We have the TV media and the records. And the only extra special thing that we had that sustained us was the privilege of working with and listening to and learning from the great black stars that we had in those days. And everything that I learned from fabulous musicians like Basie and Ellington and listening to the great lady singers and working under difficult conditions. So it gave us a certain sense of self and stamina, which was needed in those days.
As you view or think of those performers that you worked with, that seems to be a time that, in a sense, unfortunately, has passed. The excitement that was generated by those performers, is that over? Will we see that kind of...
Well, I don't know that the audience nowadays feels that that's necessary. I see people who are so numb, and thank God we have the box, but watching the TV, and they're used to movement and a picture catching their eye, and it's a little strange. I go sometime to do a TV show, and I'm disconcerted because everybody's looking this way, and I'm standing here looking and working to them, but it's the whole generation of change, of the way they receive things.
Everything changes.
Yes, everything changes, and sometimes
and
for the best.
And in some respect, stays the same.
Yes, yes.
I wonder, when you think of your early life as a youngster, disciplines that were learned mm-hmm. during those years, mm-hmm. what they may have been that carry you over into today and your performing?
Well, we always believed, I don't know why, that the show had to go on, whether we were dying or not. And I was always taught to rehearse a lot and be professional. And that has many meanings. And you were always there and ready and on time in case the act before you was sick and you had to go on earlier than you thought. All those little things that are just pure... it's not so much professionalism as it is not dedication even, it's discipline. Mm-hmm. We were taught to be disciplined people. And I envy now the fact that I love all the young singers, and I'm crazy about Aretha Franklin. And the first time I heard her years back, and I heard this freedom and this openness coming from her, I was so proud, and I wept also, because I said, God, how wonderful that nobody held her in a leash, and nobody kept her from opening up and showing how she felt. And it moves the audience so, and it makes you so happy and so free. And it took me many, many years to feel that kind of freedom. Mm-hmm.
I understand that your grandmother was a very close friend of Mary McLeod Bethune. Did you have an opportunity to meet Mary McLeod?
Oh, yes. She first enlisted me in the National Council of Negro Women. I met Mrs. Bethune, and she always was gentle to me and very sweet because she loved my grandmother. And she's one of the reasons I'm a Delta, because I started the National Council. From there, I just got...
I would have to believe that, you know, she is perhaps one of the reasons that you persevered.
Well, I think my grandmother and Mrs. Bethune and women like that had a great deal to do with the way I am, because I was left when I was 3 years old, and I went to live in the South and other places with strangers, and there was always a strong activist black woman, whether she was working in the kitchen of some white person or whether she was a church leader or whether she was a beautician. There was always that example for me.
Is the black woman today as strong as in previous years?
Well, I think she is, but she's strong for many different reasons than we were. I mean, history has made us always give more. That's the great third dimension that black people have. Their blackness is another part that keeps you together and keeps you using that to be strong.
What thoughts do you have for young black entertainers that are going to have to fight that fight?
I hope it won't be the same struggle. And I get so many, my attention gets drawn not only just to people in the artistic field, but in other lines too. I mean, we've lagged behind, I think, in the music media more than other walks of life. I see many black men and women now in all the fields that we wanted to get in a long time ago, in business and architects and industry, and I just wish there was more of that. But I don't think they'll have the same stresses. But I find also a kind of attitude that I've put all young black people and young white people more or less together, because they're going through a bad period now, and economically speaking, and getting jobs. It's rough for everybody. It's always rougher, I think, for minority groups, but I've learned to be much more sympathetic toward all sorts of people and all sorts of colors, because our stresses now are worldwide, and they're about the whole thing, not just our group, their group.
I heard recently, with much distress, that you were going to retire.
Well, from cabaret, yes, I am. This is the last year. I'm finishing up some engagements I had booked the year before. And of course, this tour with Delta is something else. That's one that is emotionally very satisfying. But I'm tired of clubs.
Will you be doing concerts?
Yes, more or less this type of thing. And TV. I just did another thing for your networks over in London. I just got back, and I guess it'll be shown in a couple of months. And I'll be going back again in January.
We will certainly look forward to that. Yes. I'd like to wish you continued success and happiness in everything that you do.
Thank you.
It's
and
been
I want you to continue and grow in your field.
I've
met a great many young people today in the medium, and I'm so proud of it. Proud of you.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
In our interview with Nikki, you will see how these days and times have fostered the openness that Lena spoke of so proudly. How strength is the common carrier in both generations. As Nikki brings out in this next interview, how one generation builds on the one before.
Is your new book, Cotton Candy on a Rainy Day, a departure from your earlier writing styles? And if so, is it more personal?
Gee, I really am. I always have a hard time answering questions like that, because to me it's a logical outgrowth of my first book, that one is obligated to grow, to learn something. That what would be the point in 1980, I think Cotton Candy came out in 78, what would be the point between 1967, which was my first book, and 1978 of not having grown somewhat? So that, no, I don't think it's a great departure. I think that it shows some maturation. I hope so.
Is it a conscious kind of growth? You talk about growth from perhaps one book, one writing to another. Is it something that's done consciously or something that just takes place?
Well, I think a little bit of both. You only a fool would not learn from an experience. You know, you never try to put yourself in a position of being a fool. That if something happens, there is a lesson there. Sometimes you have to think about it for a long time. But there is there's a lesson in everything. So that on that level, yes, it's very conscious. On the other hand, from say my first book to my last, I've traveled all around the world. So there's going to be a change. Just the fact that you go to Africa, you go to Asia, you go to Europe, to the Caribbean, it's going to change you. If it doesn't, there's no point in you going. If you're going to be the same girl you were when you left Knoxville, Tennessee, then you may as well have stayed in Knoxville, Tennessee. Something, you know. So that's sort of like an unconscious process, that you see things. You see things that make you happy, you see things that make you sad. But as long as you're alive, you're participating in the process of life.
You're an artist who expresses herself through writing. I wonder why writing, why not some other forms of art? Why have you turned to writing?
I agree with all the writers that writing turned to us. You know, we were, somebody said, well, how come you're a poet or something like that? But I don't think a writer chooses his form. I think that the form chooses the writer. There's no way on earth that I could write a play. It would never happen. I don't even think like that. But you have here in Detroit a young man, Ron Milner, whom I've known forever. Ron will never write a poem. I mean, he thinks in plays. That's all he thinks about. You know, he sees characters, he sees scenes. And I think that's terrific. I think it's terrific. But every writer has his own discipline.
If I asked you to kind of view yourself, can you possibly think of yourself as a typical black woman?
No, I think it would be folly if I said I was typical. I mean, I hate people that do that, that run around, you know, they've done everything, and then all of a sudden, I'm using ordinary Joe. No, I think that I'm not typical at all. But I think that what I share with other black women is an insatiable curiosity and a desire to make things better. I think that that's the commonality that we come together on. I am a great cheerleader for black women, as we all know. I think that black women are a terrific asset to the planet Earth. And I think that at any point that I can be helpful to us, to black women particularly, because what we do for black women, we do for black people. And that's been said 8 million times in 8 million different ways. What we do for black men, we do for them. So that I think that when we reach to share an experience with black women, we're doing something for the totality of us. But you know, words like typical, I think that one of the things that people like me have to recognize is our atypicality. And then to see how we can use what it is that we have that has made us different to help somebody else come along with us. I mean, one reason we're sitting here at Masonic is that I believe in Lillian Bimbo and the idea that DST Telecommunications should be doing something, that there should be a circuit. I don't need a circuit. I really don't. It's not like, you know, wow, Nikki Giovanni. It's that I have created my own circuit. But there are young black poets who will never have the chance that I had, and it would be incorrect for me to assume that they could do it. So that if I'm in a position to help make it possible for somebody else to do it, then I should do that. It's not a burden, it's not a problem. It's just what you should do. It's a part of your life that you give to your public.
Then you mean that you feel through your own efforts that perhaps some young black poets will have an opportunity step out of their current roles and perhaps in some respect into your own shoes.
Oh, not my shoes, into theirs. Mm-hmm. And hopefully outstrip me. I mean, there's no point in me having trod the path that I tried if nobody else is going to be able to go further. I mean, that's why people have children. We have children for a lot of different reasons, I suppose, accidents, most of them. But you have children, basically, so that you can start somebody off where you finished. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So whether it's our literary children, or our physical children, or our emotional children, our psychological children, what you're doing is letting somebody start with the 36, in my case, with the 36 years of my experience. I want somebody to be able to say, okay, now since Nikki learned that, I can go forward. Not to have to repeat what I did.
Then it's a constant kind of, in thinking in terms of the young people, it's a constant kind of progression, much as Roots, for example, where we saw, perhaps for the first time, family situation that was there and then gone, and the children taking up where the parents left.
Well, I come from a great family. I think I've been very fortunate in my immediate physical family that, yes, you continue. Wherever you started, my great-grandfather was a slave. My grandfather attended Fisk University and wanted to be a Latin scholar, was a Latin scholar, in fact. It's just that he couldn't find a job because nobody was hiring black men to be Latin scholars at that particular point. But he was a dreamer, is my point. And his dream was not realizable because of a number of situations. So that he became a Latin teacher in a local high school, and he did very well. He took care of his wife and his three children. My mother had me. I'm also a dreamer. But I don't understand why my dreams can't come true. So I will continue to do what my grandfather could not do. I will fight. Mm-hmm. I am a fighter. And my son should not have to fight the same battles that I fought.
Is it true that the black woman has been the backbone of the family situation?
Well, the woman will always be the backbone of any family. There is no such thing as a family that we know of in the animal kingdom or the kingdom of man, that the woman is not the backbone. I was just up in Boston recently, and I was talking because they were upset. The white women are always trying to get black women involved in their equal opportunities situations. And I said, but you know, really, when you start to talk about racism, you're talking about white women. Mm-hmm. Because the women are always the ones who teach the children, mm-hmm. no matter what anybody says. Now men, and I'm all for men, I cheer for men. What I'm saying, what is a fact, is that the family is set by the woman. Mm-hmm. And what makes that significant in terms of black women is that when black women are asked to join with white women, we are simply compelled to remember that it was white women that spat on black children. Mm-hmm. You understand? I'm not excluding the men from that process mm-hmm. of fatherhood. I think that one of the great movements in America today right now is the movement for paternity and paternal rights. I think that this will be good.
What did in your own mind, the 70s bring? And what do you think the 80s will hold, especially as the 80s relate to black men and women of the world?
New definitions. I mean, without question. The 70s, I consider, I wrote a poem, Cotton Candy on a Rainy Day. I consider that the 70s were that was the lonely decade. Everybody got into themselves, but not really, nobody was happy with it. You know, you never saw so many lonely, sad people. But I think that the 80s are going to be a time of new definitions. Because I think that we need a basic redefinition of life. We need a basic redefinition of what a man and a woman is, how do we respond to each other, what do we do, where do we go forward, what is the difference between a human being and a baby seal, or a whale, or a tree, or a snail daughter, what right do we have to build a teleco dam and destroy a species, you understand what I mean? These are definite, but again, because we are black, we who have been without power would be in the unique position to make the definition, because we have never benefited from the old system. So I'm rather looking forward to us using our heads once again, because it is not the first time black people have thought their way through it. The impacts that have been made in the West have been made through black people. And I think it's time that we utilized our energies once again to make some changes in this, many, many changes, not only in America, but in planet Earth.
In relating to the 80s then, do we forget the 40s, the 50s, and the 60s, and the 70s? Or do we in some way hold those somewhat sacred and view the things that have taken place.
I'm not the right person to talk about sacred. Nothing is sacred. It is all there to be learned from. The 40s were necessary to the 60s, as a matter of fact. a city like Detroit, I used to spend an awful lot of time here in Detroit, you know, if we hadn't moved those blacks out of the South into these factories, we would not have gotten the situation that we got, and I think that it was a necessary situation. Mm-hmm. I think that Motown Industries, I'm sorry that Detroit lost, because I think that LA is such a terrible place, you know, to be. And I like Tom Brady, but LA is nothing. And I think that the kind of energy that Motown represented among black people is a necessary energy. I'd like to see something else happening. But you realize that it's all a cycle. Life is a cycle, you know, you just keep going. So there's nothing that can be put aside, but there's also nothing to be held sacred. Everything is up for grabs. You have to ask a question every time, why? And how do we go beyond that?
But there is something to be learned from those.
There's something to be learned from 1619. You know, that a people who do not know, but that's an old expression. He who does not know history is condemned to repeat it. I think it's quite true.
I wonder, am I correct in assuming that at some point you said that you were both intrigued and disappointed that the books being published now hardly give any notice to the black contributions, especially in the 60s? And if so, could you elaborate on that?
I'm sure I said disappointed. I'm not sure if I said intrigued, because racism in America is so entrenched. I mean, it's almost cliche to speak of racism, but we keep seeing it, that we are still educating white youngsters, and they are assuming that they are educated with only the contributions of white people. This is an insanity. We are miseducating those people, that they don't realize that black people, let alone black women, have contributed, let alone what Africa has contributed. And it's been much more than muscle and blood and skin and bone, as they say. I mean, that's ridiculous, that the culture of the West is from black people. There's nothing, and I think it's fair to say, that there is nothing unique in white history. You're not gonna find it. I mean, from things like, and I used to laugh, you look at Richard the Lionhearted, there are no lions. What does England know about lions? Only because it's a colonial power. You know, there are no lions in England. There are no colors. You understand what I'm saying? They didn't weave cloth. They didn't invent the wheel. They didn't smelt iron. This is what we did. And I think that one of the things we as a people have to do, hopefully without a lot of arrogance, but certainly with some, is to reclaim who we are. We are the cultural bearers of planet Earth. It's that simple.
How do we change that kind of view? Even among some of us as black people, we seem to avoid looking at that view of what has been accomplished.
We don't read enough, first of all. We certainly don't talk to each other enough. And we certainly have miseducated, I think, at least the second generation at this point. Seriously miseducated, because at this point, we are assuming that they are educated, if you follow what I'm... Mm-hmm. I mean, there was a time that in the 1930s and 1940s, you knew that you had an educational lapse. You understood that. When you graduated from high school, you knew that you had problems, that you were not, in fact, prepared for college, so you worked on it. And by the time September came around, you prepared, you were ready. You were a good student. But now everybody feels that they are educated, that they know everything, that they've seen everything. People actually think that they can look at the 6 o'clock news and know what goes on in the world. That they saw it on Cronkite, or they read it in the New York Times. You know, I mean, it's ridiculous. You cannot know anything without at least reading books, preferably going there.
Why do we feel that way, then? Why do we feel that
society? Society. People feel that they're full when they eat at McDonald's. You understand? And you're not. You know, no, it's the same thing, that we're living in an age that continues to feed into a basic arrogance of mankind. It's ridiculous. It's killing us.
What's the answer? What's the total answer?
Knowledge. Knowledge is power. Reading is fundamental. We have got to simply go to that lonely place that says, I want to learn. Not, you know, what the people don't know. I love it. People are the people. No, no. It's about what I want to learn. It's about me sitting down with that book and saying, I will understand this. I will think this one through myself. If I have another question, I will go to the next book and the next book. It's about books to a great degree. But you realize the Moors have a great history of scholarship. This is not new. The libraries of Timbuktu. When we were in power, it was the books. What did Anthony do? He burned the library at Alexandria. He didn't do that because he was cold.
When does it start? At what age does it start?
Yesterday, before you're born. They
it's already
me.
Late.
I have a 10-year-old now, and I got teased a lot. I believe in prenatal. I believe the children of people, first of all. I believe that everything relates to everything. I'm not freaky or cosmic. You know, I eat meat, and it's not like that. It's just that I believe that everything is a part of the whole. So when I was pregnant with my son, whom I thought was my daughter, one of the things I started to do was to read to him. I just read, you know, whatever I was reading, I would read out loud. And he said, what are you doing that for? I said, so that the baby can hear me read, because your voice is different. Now, I don't know what effect that actually had on Thomas, because when he came out, of course, like all children, he could not talk. But I read to him as a baby when he could not pay attention to me. And I know that to this day, the one thing that he loves is books. It's the only thing he has that he'll take care of.
That's an interesting thought, because when my mother was carrying me, she said that she had the feeling that she should read absolutely everything she could get her hands on, because she felt that it would affect me, whomever I might have been. And that's the same kind of thought, in a sense.
It's an experience, sure. Yes. It's a shared experience. That doesn't say that the kid would come out reading Greek or knowing metaphysics. It just says that you have shared something that is precious. And the quest for knowledge, and this is not just a mother and child, it is a family, a community, our national situation. The quest for knowledge must be paramount. Simply must be.
Where is your writing going? Where are you going in your writing?
I don't know. I'm playing with the idea of trying to write a novel. I'm trying to write a novel. Mm-hmm. I don't know. All poets think they can write novels, and all novelists think they can write poetry. So we all kind of, you know, lock heads at some point or another. I'm interested in exploring human beings, so it's an endless question. You know, endless.
Speaking to you has been a delightful honor. You are an extremely talented lady, and I thank you for.
I'm glad you've been in Detroit. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Well, you have seen and heard two beautiful witnesses to the description, "To be woman, gifted, and black, one generation to another." Perhaps the word strong should be inserted in our title somewhere, for Lena and Nikki both excel in strength as well as talent. And perhaps that's the commonality of all black women, a legacy of strength passed from generation to generation and growing all the time.
Is the black woman with the changing times as strong today as in previous years?
Well, I think she is, but she's strong for many different reasons than we were. Mm-hmm. I mean, history has made us always give more. That's the great third dimension that mm-hmm. black people have. Their blackness is another part mm-hmm. that keeps you together and keeps you using that to be strong.
So that I think that when we reach to share an experience with black women, we're doing something for the totality of us. But, you know, words like typical, I think that one of the things that people like me have to recognize is our atypicality, and then to see how we can use what it is that we have that has made us different to help somebody else come along with us. I mean, one reason we're sitting here at Masonic is that I believe in Lillian Benbow and the idea that DST telecommunications should be doing something, that there should be a circuit. I don't need a circuit. I really don't. It's not like, you know, wow, Nikki Giovanni. It's that I have created my own circuit. But there are young black poets who will never have the chance that I had.
No one can change the path that you must go. What you feel and know you're right. When you say it's yours, believe that you can go home.